Good afternoon, or good morning, sorry. The first item of business this morning is consideration of business motion 490 in the name of Joe Fitzpatrick on behalf of the Parliamentary Bureau setting out a revision to the business programme. I would ask any member who wishes to speak against the motion to press the request to speak button now. And Joe's not here. I wonder if I could ask Mr Ewing to move the business motion in the name of Joe Fitzpatrick.
Formally moved.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. No member is asked to speak against the motion. I now put the question to the Chamber. The question is that motion number 490 in the name of Joe Fitzpatrick, but moved by Fergus Ewing, is accepted. Do we agree?
Yes.
We agree. Thank you. The next item of business is general questions. I call question number one, Tavish Scott.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government when it last met representatives of the fishing industry to discuss the discard ban.
Cabinet Secretary Fergus Ewing.
Presiding Officer, my officials last met with our Scottish Discard Steering Group on the 17th of March this year to discuss the discard ban. This group includes representatives from the fishing industry, NGOs and fishermen. The next meeting is planned to take place on 24th of June. I will be meeting with representatives from the fishing industry on the 20th of June at the Scottish Fishermen's Federation Executive Committee meeting, at which the discards ban will be a topic for discussion.
Tavish Scott.
Well, thank you. I'm grateful to the Cabinet Secretary for that reply in amongst his very busy ministerial responsibilities, which have been added to this morning. Could he be aware of the concerns of the shet and whitefish industry over the implementation of the discard ban, in particular in relation to choke species, the need for a flexible and pragmatic approach to those particular problems? And will he agree to meet specifically with the Shetland Fishermen's Association when he next takes the opportunity to visit Shetland in his ministerial responsibilities?
Cabinet Secretary.
We look forward to such a visit and such a meeting in due course. For the uninitiated, Presiding Officer, choke species are fish species for which quotas are so limited relative to local or general abundance that the imposition of a landing obligation is liable to result in fishing vessels having to cease operations well before they've caught their main quota allocations. It's therefore an extremely serious threat, and one on which we're working very, very carefully. Of course, identifying choke species in advance is important, as are potential solutions such as quota transfer, quota swaps, and the 5% de minimis exemption. But I'm very well aware that this is a matter of extreme importance among the fishing community as a whole, and therefore that is why I'm meeting with the, principally why I'm meeting with the fishing representatives on Monday of next week.
Sandra White.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what plans it has to introduce legislation regarding responsible parking on footways.
Sorry, Ms White, I called you early for the question. I thought you were asking a supplementary on question one. Beg your pardon.
Can I not just go ahead, Presiding Officer?
No, your time will come, Mrs White. Can I call Finlay Carson, who is asking a supplementary on this question?
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Would the Scottish Government agree that the planned termination of the grace period for fishermen affected by the discard ban on the 1st of January 2017, on the same date that cod and other choke species are included in the ban, makes no sense and will unduly punish demersal fishermen already struggling with its implementation, and as such agree that the grace period should be extended?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, we are aware, of course, as the public are, they want to see an end to discards. I mean, discards is one of the aspects of the fishing policy which I think has caused a great concern amongst the public and amongst fishermen as well, because it's an incredible waste. And therefore, the landing obligation must come in by 2019. However, we have sought to deal with this so far as we can in Scotland by discussion, by consideration, by negotiation. I've already had discussions with Mike Park, for example, and others, and I will continue to do so. The member is quite right to highlight the concerns, and I can assure him and everybody who represents a fishing community, excepting, of course, Sandra White, that these matters are being pursued very diligently by myself and my officials.
Question number two, Kate Forbes.
To ask the Scottish Government what progress is being made to reintroduce passenger flights from Ashaghe Airfield on Skye?
Minister Hamza Youssef.
We recognise the aspirations of communities in the Skye area to restart regular air services
to and from the island of Skye, and we would be happy to discuss the issue with them. However, any future development of the airstrip is, of course, a matter for Highland Council as the owners of the site.
Kate Forbes.
The Minister will be aware that for rural island economies, physical connectivity is critical for business success. And the Skye brand is world-renowned, drawing visitors in and exporting products. Does the Minister agree that we need to ensure that there are adequate transport links, including decent roads, reliable ferries, and an air service for business growth?
Minister.
I, of course, agree with everything that Kate Forbes has said. I was delighted to meet with her in the first couple of weeks of the role, and she mentioned a number of these issues, of course, including the airstrip at Broadford. And I understand the importance of transport issues to the islands in particular, and of course across rural communities in Scotland. That's why I've chosen to meet with the MSPs and the elected members across the country to discuss these issues. In terms of the actual airport itself, I understand there's a study that's been commissioned by HIE, Hitrans and Highland Council to look into the issue of the airstrip. I can give an assurance to the member that once that study is ready, I'd be willing to sit down with stakeholders. But on a wider issue of connectivity to Skye and indeed to the islands and rural areas, of course I agree with her. And I also agree with her on the allure of Skye. It's undeniable for tourism, but also not just internationally, but domestically here in Scotland too.
Edward Mountain.
I'd like to thank you for that answer. Given the original survey of the airfield suggested it would cost in excess of £15.3 million to refurbish it and make it fit for flight, it's unlikely, I would suggest, the Highland Council will have the funds to do that. Are the Scottish Government in a position to assist them with that?
Minister.
I thank the member for the question. This is precisely why HIE, Hitrans and Highland Council have decided to commission another study to try to see where they can look to reduce that cost. It should be said that the upper range was £15.3 million. If he looks at the report, actually the lower end of that is about £2.5 million. But this is an issue for the council, but we are happy to work with them. Of course, any passenger service that exists in Broadford would need to be subsidised by the studies that we've seen thus far. And he, as you will know, we are in a position of financial constraint and difficulty. So we'd have to have those conversations with openness, with frankness, but I've got no problem having those conversations. And if the elected member wanted to join them, he is, of course, welcome to do so.
Question number three, Sandra White.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. We do, of course, have salmon in the River Kelvin and my constituency, so there is a fish question there. But thank you very much for your indulgence in that respect. To ask the Scottish Government what plans it has to introduce legislation regarding responsible parking on footways.
Minister Hubsey Yusuf.
I feel like taking the fish puns even further, but I'm going to stop myself from doing so. Scottish Ministers are committed to bringing forward a transport bill that will include provisions that seek to enforce responsible parking. To ensure that any legislation is, of course, fit for purpose and will command the public confidence and support, a full review and stakeholder consultation will be taking place later this year. But I want to put on record, of course, the amount of great work that Sandra White has done on this issue to serve her constituents, but I believe vulnerable groups up and down Scotland.
I thank the Minister for his reply and the pledge that we'll be looking at that sometime this year, not too distant future. The Minister will be aware of the situation in my constituency in Glasgow Kelvin, where motorists have taken to actually parking wholly on the pavements to avoid double yellow lines. Does the Minister agree with me that legislation is needed urgently, and I thank him for his reply, to ensure that people can actually walk on the pavements without the danger of cars being on the pavements and them being forced to walk on the road?
Minister Hubsey Yusuf.
I saw the particular issue that Sandra White was talking about. I saw it in the Evening Times, actually, and some of the difficulty it's causing, and is causing difficulty to some of our most vulnerable groups, to carers, to those with disabilities, obviously pram users, and indeed pedestrians as well. She will know, having done the work on this previously, of some of the intricacies and the nuances in terms of enforcement issues and so on and so forth. That's why a full review and a stakeholder consultation is necessary, but I can give her the assurance that will take place in the first year of this parliamentary session.
Question number four, Graeme Simpson.
Thank you. To ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide funding so that Scottish Autism's one-stop shop in Motherwell can reopen.
Minister Maureen Ward.
We are committed to working in partnership with both North and South Lanarkshire and Scottish Autism to support the transition into local services. Scottish Government officials are in discussion with North and South Lanarkshire councils to agree how transitional funding can ensure the expert resource from Scottish Autism supports users of the one-stop shop to transfer into appropriate local services. We also want to ensure that the views of service users are represented in future local service delivery.
Graeme Simpson.
Can I thank the Minister for her answer? Unfortunately, I think this has become something of a political football between government and councils. And really, what we should be doing is putting the users first. This was an excellent initiative set up by the Scottish Government. It's been widely praised, but the problem is when the money runs out, there is nothing to replace it. I spoke earlier today to the Chief Executive of Scottish Autism, Alan Somerville, who told me that they would love to be able to carry on. I would urge the Minister, if she can, to get back round the table and ensure that this service does continue, because it's deeply painful for the parents of those involved.
Maureen Ward.
Well, can I absolutely agree with the member that, of course, the service users should be at the heart of this. But the member will know that the services provided by Scottish Autism and National Autistic Society and the Autism Initiative was part of six pilots throughout the country to provide one-stop shops. It was a pilot. It was time limited, and it was always expected that the local councils, in partnership with the integrated joint boards and the health board, would build on the experience of the one-stop shop and take it forward on that basis.
Linda Fabiani.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The Minister is, of course, aware of my ongoing concern about the implementation of autism strategy within South Lanarkshire Council, a council which, of course, Mr Simpson is an executive member of. South Lanarkshire Council have promised a one-stop shop in South Lanarkshire. Does she agree with me that they must provide at least the services which had been offered by the joint one-stop shop in Motherwell, funded by the Scottish Government and for an extended period, as well as all of their statutory obligations?
Maureen Ward.
Yes, I do absolutely agree with the member. It was always hoped that the one-stop shop would identify gaps in services and that ongoing, under the local autism strategies, which every council is expected to have, that they would build on the services that were identified and the gaps that were identified in local provision and take forward the lessons from that in providing their own services.
Mark Griffin.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Minister, it's hard to see how local authorities can carry on providing that service after the central funding runs out from the Scottish Government, especially with the budget cuts that are being handed down. But can I ask the Minister to consider additional transitional funding until the health and social care partnerships are set up, at the very least, to allow this vital service to continue until new arrangements can be put in place?
Maureen Ward.
The Cabinet Secretary has already said that they are given that Scottish Autism, if they are able to provide the services, will provide extra transitional funding until the local authorities get the service up and running, and that's already been agreed. But it is really important that both councils get round the table with the Scottish Government and with Scottish Autism to make sure that the service providers are given the service that they need.
Question number five, Marie Todd.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what progress it has made on reducing ferry fares for the Northern Isles.
Minister Hamza Youssef.
I'd like to thank the member. For the question, the SNP manifesto made clear our commitment to take action to reduce ferry fares to Orkney and Shetland. I've already met with the Northern Isles constituency MSPs, discuss the matter with them, and meeting with Highlands and Islands MSPs later on today to listen to their views. I also intend on visiting Orkney and Shetland in the summer. I look forward to meeting local authorities and stakeholders to discuss this very issue.
Marie Todd.
Thank you. I'd like to ask the Minister to explain what the impact of RET would have if it was imposed on the Northern Isles routes using the same formula as has been used in the Western Isles, please.
Minister.
RET, from the studies that we've examined, would significantly increase the majority of fares on ferry services to the Northern Isles, particularly on the routes from Aberdeen, due to obviously the longer distances involved. It is true that RET would reduce the islander fares on certain route Skrabstor to Stromness service, for example. However, introducing RET or indeed reducing fares on this route is complicated by the presence of a commercial operator, but Transport Scotland are meeting with that commercial operator later this month to discuss how fares can be reduced. But I've also tasked Transport Scotland officials to take forward work to generate options for reducing ferry fares to the Northern Islands. Decisions on that, of course, will be taken in due course.
Liam MacArthur.
Very much, Presiding Officer. Can I thank the Minister for his willingness to meet with me in early course to discuss this issue. As you'll be aware, the implementation of RET saw fares capped where they otherwise would have been increased on the West Coast routes. But as part of the discussions that he's taking forward with officials, will he remember to bear in mind the need to address the issue of the internal ferry fares within Orkney, as well as the services to and from the Scottish mainland?
Minister.
Yes, and I appreciated the meeting with Liam MacArthur on this very point, and he made that point very well, I thought. It certainly is part of the consideration that we'll make, and I endeavour to keep the member up to date on that. I look forward to meeting him when I go up to the Northern Islands. I should say his colleagues from the Shetland Isles did offer me a cup of tea when I come to Shetland. I noticed that that offer wasn't reciprocated by the member for Orkney.
David Stewart.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The next tender for the Northern Isles ferry services is in 2018. Will the Minister use the European Commission's TECL exemption so that no expensive tendering exercise is required and that the award is simply made to the public sector company, the David McGrane Group? Would the Minister agree to meet me so I can share the opinion from the Director General of the Transport for the European Commission, who said to me, the direct award of a public service contract is in principle accepted by the European Court of Justice?
Minister.
First thing to say is I sincerely hope when we have this conversation that we're still part of the EU in a week's time, and we'll be making that positive and progressive case. He knows that we have an honest disagreement about some of the issues around TECL, but what my predecessor did do was look to a joint approach with Mick Cash and those from the RMT to the European Commission. So we're looking to see the results and hear the results of that. We'll obviously keep the member updated. Of course, I'll meet with the member. I think I'm due to meet with him perhaps later today, but I'll have a one-to-one meeting with him on this very issue.
Question number six, Ruth Maguire.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what discussions it's had with NHS Ayrshire and Arran regarding mental health.
Minister Maureen Watt.
Scottish Government officials, Health Improvement Scotland and NHS Education for Scotland met with NHS territorial boards, including NHS Ayrshire and Arran, on May the 5th to discuss current performance and provide information on the Mental Health Improvement Programme. Health Improvement Scotland also met with NHS Ayrshire and Arran on the 10th of May to discuss the tailored support which will be provided to the board throughout the programme. The Improvement Programme will work in collaboration with NHS boards to deliver sustained improvement in access to CAMHS and psychological therapy services.
Ruth Maguire.
Thank you. I thank the Minister for that answer. I'd like to welcome the Scottish Government's investment in North Ayrshire's new health and social care partnership community mental health facility, Woodland View. I hope the Minister will have the opportunity to visit soon and meet with staff to hear about the new models of care. Shifting the balance of care from acute to community settings is a challenge at times of an increasing demand. Can the Minister detail how the Scottish Government will support North Ayrshire Health and Social Care Partnership to continue to transform support and care for our people facing mental health issues?
Minister.
Well, Presiding Officer, I look forward to visiting Woodland View and seeing how North Ayrshire Health and Social Care Partnership is delivering better outcomes for people with mental health issues locally. The integration of health and social care is about ensuring that those who use services get the right care and support, whatever their needs at any point in their care journey. The partnership has benefited from Scottish Government investment in increasing access to mental health services and primary care, and I'll be interested to see how this is being used locally.
Question number seven, Lewis MacDonald.
To ask the Scottish Government what decisions it has made about the future provision of major trauma centres in the NHS.
Minister Maureen Watt.
As you are all aware, the Cabinet Secretary has confirmed that there will be four trauma centres in Scotland: Aberdeen, Dundee, Edinburgh and Glasgow. These centres will operate within an inclusive national trauma network to help deliver improved outcomes for severely injured patients across Scotland.
Lewis MacDonald.
That decision, of course, is very welcome. The Minister will recall that when the original commitment to four major trauma centres was made 2 years ago, the then Cabinet Secretary made a commitment that they would be operational from 2016. Yet the Scottish Government press release issued yesterday quoted the current Cabinet Secretary as saying that the preparatory work would be completed by the end of the year. I wonder if Maureen Watt can tell us when the government expects to move on from preparatory work to making the major trauma centres operational and delivering the pledge to enhanced major trauma care.
Minister.
Well, as the Cabinet Secretary has announced, she has the Chief Medical Officer will chair a new National Trauma Network Implementation Group to take this work forward. It's extremely important that we plan the trauma network thoroughly to make sure that we get it right, and we will not be pressed into implementing a model that doesn't suit Scotland's circumstances or that has not been properly thought through. We will take time to plan and deliver a bespoke solution that will best serve the people of Scotland.
Thank you.